So I'm Ravi Ganti. And this talk is about active, positive, semidefinite matrix completion with applications to large-scale bandit problems. This is joint work with Anuradha Bhargava and Robert Novak, both at UW Madison. So I'm going to talk about two problems, which might seem quite disconnected to start with, but I promise that there'll be a connection. The two problems are active, positive, semidefinite matrix completion and a certain large-scale bandit problem. And we'll define algorithms, and we'll also look at like empirical results for these algorithms. OK, let's start with the first problem, which is active, positive, semidefinite matrix completion. So low-rank positive semidefinite matrices are ubiquitous in machine learning. Whenever we use covariance matrices, kernel machines, we essentially end up working with low-rank positive semidefinite matrices. Querying the elements of the matrix in certain cases could be very expensive, right? So if you want to fill up the entries of the matrix, some of the computations to fill up the entries of the matrix could be very expensive. So it would be interesting to find to have algorithms that can fill in few of the elements, like you explicitly compute few of the elements of the kernel matrix, and then using these few elements kind of like complete the rest of the matrix. So that is the active PFG completion problem. So let me state it more formally. You have an unknown k by k rank R PFG matrix, L. Let's assume we know rank what R is for now. You have an oracle. The oracle, when you query it with ij, it will return to you the value of the matrix L at row I and column j. We'll consider both kinds of oracles, so stochastic oracles as well as deterministic oracles. And the task is as follows. So we want to query the oracle very few times and construct an estimate of L such that this estimate is close to L with an epsilon error. So what I mean by that is that I want an element-wise reconstruction error for the matrix L. So this is a bit weird because typically when people do matrix completion, they think about Frobenius norm completion or two norm completion, but we are talking about kind of like infinity norm completion if you look at it as a vector. But it will become clear why we want to go after this task. Okay, so let me switch and talk about a slightly different problem, and you'll get to see why I'm talking about this problem very soon. So here's a large scale bandit problem. So you have R populations. So just as a running example, let's say R is 2, and you have K movies. So let's say people who love action movies and people who love comedy movies. Okay, each population can be described by an unknown k-dimensional preference vector, which tells you that if you were to choose a random user from that population, what's the chance, what's the probability that they will like this movie I? So that's why it's like a k-dimensional vector. User comes from one of these populations, but we assume that we do not know what the membership of the user is. So he may be from the action movie lovers or the comedy movie lovers, but we don't know where he's from. We show two movies each time, right? So think of it as like a cold start problem. You have a new user coming in. You want to show two movies each time. And user tells us which movies he or she likes. So they're not comparing movies. They're just telling you when you show movie I and J, whether they like movie I or not, and whether they like movie J or not. They're not comparing these movies, okay? And they might not like any of the movies, so that's also okay. So the question is, what's the best pair of movies to show on an average? Like you are trying to do a cold start run, and you want to show just two movies. Which are the first two movies that you want to show them? So let me tell you what the reward structure that we are going after is. So we assume that the user clicks on the movies are independent of each other. So, the best pair of movies I star and J star should be one which kind of like optimize this optimization problem, which is argmin of an expectation term. So let me just pass this expectation term out. So VT is the membership of the user that comes in. Okay, so he's sampled from a probability distribution of size R, and and we don't know what the membership is though. So, and the U vector is a preference vector, which is indexed by ZT, which tells us what's the preference for this user for a movie I, right? So this expectation term that I have there is basically the probability that the user will not click on any of these movies, I or J, right? So if you minimize that, and you find out which pair of movies this expectation is the smallest, that's a good pair of movies to show. But I'll put forth a constraint, which is that you can think of this as a bandit problem, where there are k-square arms, all pairs of movies, but you're not allowed to try out all k-square choices, right? So typical bandit problems are you have some number of arms, and you can like sample each arm many times. But here we have too many arms, k-square arms, but you're not allowed to, the number of trials allowed is like far smaller than k-square. And a question is like how many trials are enough to kind of like pick up the best pair, IJ? So this seems kind of impossible, but it's not that bad. So if you think of the reward matrix formed by this setup, this can be thought of as a matrix one minus the expectation. If you open up the expectation, it turns out to be the summation of pk times 1 minus uk, 1 minus uk transpose. So it is the matrix 1 minus a positive semidefinite matrix by construction, which has rank at most r. It has rank at most r. So if you can approximate this low rank matrix r, l, accurately enough on an element by element basis, then you can also find out the smallest element. That smallest element in the matrix corresponds to the best choice pair of movies I, comma, j. So that's why we considered the max norm error when I introduced the PFT matrix completion problem. So let's look at some algorithms for PFT matrix completion in isolated setting. The important property that we exploit, and this property is only true for PFT matrices, not for general matrices, is that if you take a look at any number of columns, let's say just three columns, just as an example, this is column C1, column C2, and the seventh column C3, then these three columns are linearly independent if and only if the small principal submatrix, which I have shown to the left, which is a blue matrix, which is formed which is a principal submatrix corresponding to columns C1, C2, C3, if that matrix is full rank. So what I mean is, construct the principal submatrix formed by columns C1, C2, C3, which it's basically the small 3x3 matrix formed by columns C1, C2, C3, and the corresponding rows. So in this case, it would be rows 1, 2, and 7, because column C3 is the seventh column. So if you take a look at that small principal submatrix, if that matrix is full rank, then these columns are independent, and the other way around too. So that's good, because you can tell a lot about these three columns by just looking at like 9 entries instead of looking at 3k entries. So that's the basis of the algorithm. So the algorithm is very simple. You start by observing the first column, okay? And I'm assuming that this column is non-zero. Then you check if the second column is independent of the first column or not. And to do that check, you just need to check if this 2x2 principal submatrix that I have to the leftmost corner, if that is full rank or not. That's very simple. You can do that. I'm assuming it's noiseless setup. Okay, if it is, let's suppose it turns out that this 2x2 matrix is full rank, then you add that matrix as one more column. So you query the entire column now. Now you want to check if the third column is independent of the first two columns. You repeat this procedure. You look at the leftmost principal submatrix formed by columns 1, 2, 3. In this case, maybe it is not, so you just ignore. You don't query any more entries from that column, and then you repeat. You repeat, repeat, repeat until you run out of columns, and then you're done, right? So you're done. Now you're done. So, and basically, now you have queried a bunch of columns. For some of the columns, you have not queried anything, like you haven't queried the entire column. So you have a bunch of column C, which you have fully queried. You will construct the principal submatrix corresponding to these columns. Let's call that matrix FW. Then an estimate of the matrix is simply CW inverse C transpose. This is just a nice sum extension. And in the noiseless case, it's very easy to show that this estimate exactly recovers the original matrix L. So this is an algorithm. So you, basically you keep checking if principal submatrices are full rank. If yes, you query that column. Otherwise, you just ignore that column. And it's very easy to see that, well, it's a little bit of thought. You'll see that the query complexity is k times r, corresponding to the r columns that you'll fully query, and k minus r for all those remaining columns that you did not query. So that's kr plus k minus r. And as you can see, the way I described it, you did not even need to know the full rank. You did not even need to know the rank r, so you don't need the knowledge of rank r. It's much faster than solving nuclear norm minimization, which is typically used for matrix completion, under general low-rank matrix completion. And this is order optimal, right? So you have a k by k PFT matrix. Its rank is r. It has k eigenvectors, r eigenvalues, so it has kr plus r components. And you're essentially querying little more than that. But it's order optimal. And you don't need any incoherence assumptions, which are typically present in low-rank matrix completion problems. OK. So this is for the noiseless setup. You can do it very neatly. But in the noisy setup, where you have kind of like a stochastic oracle, where you query the ijth element, and you get a noisy value of the ijth element, you can use this algorithm, but with a little bit of modifications. So here we use some multi-arm bandit ideas. We say that, OK, we'll think of it as we'll think of it as follows. We'll have k arms corresponding to the principal submatrices formed by column 1 and every other column. And then we'll run success elimination. And the reward is going to be the smallest singular value of the submatrix, right? So, and you can see why that's a good reward, because you want to check if that principal submatrix is full rank or not. And you can run success elimination, and that will eliminate all the arms except one arm, and then you can repeat this procedure. So success elimination, you need to estimate the smallest singular value for all principal submatrices, you need to construct confidence bounds, and then you eliminate submatrices which have very small singular values with high probability. I'm being a bit hazy. You can take a look at the paper for the full description. So let me go through some experimental results. So here is an experiment with the MovieLens dataset. So what we did was we took the MovieLens dataset, which has some number of movies, some number of users. There are some incomplete ratings. So we applied standard low-rank matrix completion to complete the entries. And then we clustered the users as per different clustering attributes. So in the first figure on the left, we clustered the users as per their occupation. On the second figure on the right, we clustered users as per their gender. And now what we do is for each of these clusters, we calculate a preference vector. And then we use that to construct the matrix L. We only provide the matrix L to the algorithm only by a noisy oracle. And as you can see, our algorithm, which is FMCANS, which is stochastic matrix completion via adaptive Nystrom sampling, it has lower error as we query more and more, and it beats other algorithms such as naive algorithm, which kind of like applies its budget uniformly over all the k-square choices, and LIL, which is a UCB algorithm using sophisticated law of iterated logarithm type of bounds. It beats it by margin, so we continue to learn even as we get more and more samples, whereas the other two algorithms kind of fail. That's because they're treating this problem as a k-square arm bandit problem, and they're not exploiting the structure. So that's why they kind of like tend to stop learning, whereas we tend to continue to learn because we focus more and more queries on a very small part of the matrix. I have more results. For example, we also experimented out with a dimensionality reduction problem where you say that you have a kernel matrix and maybe you want to use this kernel matrix in t-SNE, and you get to query only a few elements of this kernel matrix and you get to complete the rest of the elements. And we show that in the full paper, we show that when you use our completion algorithm in t-SNE, it gives much better clusters than when you use simple low-rank matrix completion, which does not exploit the PFT structure in the problem. So in conclusion, we gave provable simple algorithms for PFT matrices under active queries. The algorithm uses, it's a really nice algorithm. It uses a combination of bandit techniques, plus some linear algebraic techniques, even for the simple matrix completion problem. In the process, we derived new results for matrix approximation in max norm. Typically, people do not look at max norm, but because of an application, we had to look at max norm, so that needed deriving new results. We demoed some applications to bandit problems. The experiments have, in the full paper, we have experiments to kernel dimensionality reduction. And you can think of like many other extensions, right? So we don't have a sense of context here. We just looked for the best pair of arms over the whole population, but you can add in context and say that, okay, what's the best pair of movies that I can show to this person? You can, so when I was describing experiments, I said that there's a clustering structure and each cluster has a preference. You can extend this to some flat clusters to hierarchical clustering. Lots more extensions that you can think of. So for the full paper was published at AI Stats, and this is the title of the paper. It's called Active Positive Semidefinite Matrix Completion, Algorithms, Theory, and Applications. Thank you.